respect and freedom always go together. Always. You cannot respect the other unless you are free. If you are not free, then the respect that you are observing is not respect, it is bondage. Only in my freedom can I really love or respect. That is one thing. Second, if you do not know respect, then how are you free? So respect and freedom anyway go together. Mostly when we display or practice respect, it is out of a sense of compulsion. That is why our respect is so hollow. Have you seen how people show respect to deities or to religious places or to elders or to social institutions? Have you seen? Is that a real respect? You are compelled to display respect. And obviously that respect then means nothing. Are you not required to behave in particular ways when at certain places, let's say even at the court or in a temple or a mosque or in front of family elders? Were that respect to emerge out of your deep conviction, it would have a weight, an authenticity. But rarely does that respect emerge out of your own volition. It comes from fear. You know that if you don't do what is demanded of you, there is a price to pay. Right? So respect and freedom will go together. Secondly, if you are not free, how will you see? To respect something, to take something as big, worthy, you must first of all be able to know that thing. And knowing is possible only in freedom. You respect something only when you find it immense, right? Only when you see that it is not limited, that it is beyond pettiness. Then rises respect from your heart. How will you see anything if you are not free to see, if your eyes are not open? How? But the ego loves to create a distinction between freedom and respect. In fact, the ego says, you are not free to disrespect. Do you not hear that often? You are not free to disrespect. The fact is that unless you are not free to disrespect, there is no possibility of respect either. Unless you are not free to freely disrespect, there is no possibility of respect either. Freedom and respect will go together. It will hurt the other person. What in the other person would it hurt? What in the other person would it hurt? You are such a well-wisher of the ego, you don't want to hurt it. Let him assume whatever he is assuming. His assumptions are what cause his suffering. You want his suffering to continue? Don't be rash, don't be reckless in hurting the ego. But then not hurting the ego must not become an excuse for preserving the ego. If you hurt somebody's ego very recklessly, with no consideration, then that hurt will only boost the ego. That's the thing with indiscreetly trying to break the ego. If you try to break the ego without discretion, without care, without wisdom, then your effort to break the ego will only strengthen the ego. Don't you see how the other person fortifies himself, armors himself when you attack his ego? So be considerate when you are hurting somebody's ego. Considerate not in the sense that you do not want to hurt him, but in the sense that if you hurt him improperly, then his ego will only get more strength. That is one thing. Second thing, because you do not want to hurt somebody recklessly, that does not mean that you will not hurt him at all. Do hurt, but hurt with care. Do hurt, but hurt with wisdom. What else does a saint do? What else did Kabir do all his life? He kept on hurting you, didn't he? Look at how Kabir taunts you. Look at how he pinches. Look at how he points out all our lacunae. But he does it in a very sweet way. You do not feel like rebelling against him. And he never minces words. He says everything that must be said. And yet you deliberately go to him to get hurt. That is called hurting with wisdom.